Recorded Books presents Mahjong, A Chinese Game and the Making of Modern American Culture by Annelise Heinz. Narrated by Rachel Botchan. Preface. Mahjong is played with tiles instead of cards, but like a deck of cards, these tiles have suits. Now and in the past, Chinese tiles are chunky, over an inch long, about an inch wide, and at least half an inch deep. They are thick enough to stand on their ends. American tiles are thinner and stand upright with the help of a rack. Players line their hands, or set of selected tiles, up in front of them, much as card players fan their hand of cards to see their options away from the prying eyes of others. Like playing cards, the backs of the tiles are identical to ensure that players cannot identify which tiles others have. On the face of the tiles are markings that differentiate three suits: circles, bamboo, and characters. The character tiles include Chinese numbers and, most often, the character for 10,000, or yuan. These designs originate from stylized depictions of money. For example, Chinese coins with holes in the middle were the circles, and long strings of these coins evolved into sticks of bamboo. In American parlance, these are known most commonly as dots, bams, and cracks. There are four sets of tiles, 1 to 9 in each suit, totaling 36 in each. As in much of Mahjong, there are intricacies in the designs. The one bam tile, for example, depicts a bird rather than a single rod of bamboo. In addition, there are two groups of non-suited tiles, honor tiles, and flowers. Honors include the four cardinal directions, winds, and three colors, white, green, and red, known in the West as dragons. Since there are four of each of these sets, there are a total of 28 honor tiles. Flowers can have a variety of scenic images. Their name draws from one of the most common designs, with flowers that represent the seasons in traditional Chinese art. In more elaborate carvings, the tiles can be lined up in a row and recreate a scene from an iconic Chinese opera or paint a picturesque landscape. Most commonly, these markings are engraved or recessed into the face of the tiles, so experienced Chinese players take pride in knowing which tiles they draw simply by feeling the grooves with their thumbs. Flowers have been the most controversial tiles and have varied in number at times. The standard form, however, is with 8 flower tiles that all look different from each other. After 1960, the National Mahjong League changed the tiles by adding a specific set of joker tiles as well, to differentiate from the previous practice of using flowers as wild cards. Taiwanese Mahjong sets have introduced a 100 uses tile similar to American jokers, while other regional styles play with different numbers of tiles. With the exception of Japanese and Vietnamese sets, most styles of play without jokers use sets with 144 tiles. With jokers, the tiles in American sets total 152. All over the world, there are different ways of playing Mahjong, some of which have branched quite far from the original form. However, there are some core historic commonalities. Though there are many variations, these are the standard elements of play. To begin, four players begin by mixing or washing the tiles face down in the center of a square table. The clatter of the tiles against each other and the table can be quite noisy, and Mahjong players often cover the tabletop with a cloth or felt to soften the racket. The players then work together to quickly build a rough square from the tiles. Each side of the wall is a double-decker stack of two face-down tiles. The combined steps of mixing and building the wall work together as a highly effective shuffling strategy. The roll of dice determines where in the wall to begin drawing tiles. Each player takes four tiles in turn, as the players complete the initial draw. Experienced players zip along as the central square wall quickly fragments into each player's hand of 13 tiles. In the American style, players then exchange tiles in an additional shuffling process known as the Charleston. Expert American players say that the game is won or lost in the Charleston when players determine which hands they are best set up to win. In both Chinese and American standard forms, the goal is to complete a hand with a final additional tile, resulting in a winning combination of 14 tiles. We'll learn more about how American Mahjong came to be distinct from Chinese play, but in brief, the Chinese version is fairly similar to the card game Gin Rummy. Most winning hands involve four sets of three tiles and a pair, and until the birth of the National Mahjong League in the late 1930s, most Americans played that way too. After the league came into existence, they established a more limited number of acceptable hands with more variations and combinations, which change on an annual basis. For both, rules govern how tiles can be drawn from the wall or snatched from the discard pile, and how winning hands are scored. Penalties for discarding tiles that another player uses to complete a winning hand encourage defensive play. One of the hallmarks of skilled Mahjong players, whichever style they play, is an ability to track which tiles have been played, which remain, and which hands other players are likely vying to complete. Mahjong is primarily a game of skill. Luck is always present. Debates over the use of flowers or jokers have centered on whether to introduce more luck, and if that reduces the game's challenge. Learning the basics of the traditional game does not take long. Like Gin Rummy, it can be learned in the span of an afternoon. Mastering the scoring and strategy, however, can take a lifetime. The American game has a slightly steeper initial learning curve, in part because the strategy revolves around a smaller number of acceptable hands. Adherents of the different styles tend to be fiercely loyal to their own and will defend the merits of its intellectual demands or, depending on their experience, the friendly socializing it fosters. The game of bridge is a frequent point of comparison, and many American Mahjong players play bridge as well. Unlike bridge, which demands constant concentration to simply play the game, in part because it is a partnered game and one player's performance affects a partner, Mahjong involves individual players and can be played along a spectrum of competitiveness. All forms of Mahjong can be played in highly competitive, fast-paced, and demanding games. Alternatively, most forms can also be played more socially, and regular groups form according to preference. In almost any scenario, however, chatting during play or delaying the next player's turn through slowness or inattention is not suffered lightly. Each element of the game, the way the tiles look and feel, the rhythms of play, and the intellectual and social satisfaction it provides, has intersected with specific historical contexts to create social meanings. It is that history that this book reveals. Introduction. What's in a game? The tiles clatter across the table. Eight hands push and sweep them back and forth, mixing them into an erratic mass before flipping over any exposed faces to show only blank backs. The tiles are smooth and cool to the touch, small enough to be held easily with thumb against forefinger. As fingers quickly pluck tiles from the center of the table, voices punctuate the air. Nimble movements bring the tiles close to the edge of the square table, and four walls made of two layers of stacked tiles quickly take shape. A pair of hands holds two dice and rolls them in the center of the table. The Mahjong game is about to begin. envision these players in an 1890 Shanghai courtesan house. The four men do not look up as a young woman in embroidered silk pulls aside the cloth door covering to enter the room, bringing wine with her. The men's queues hang down the backs of their long robes as they focus on calculating their points. The winner will cover half their party's bill for the evening's drink and company. A tasseled lantern hangs from the ceiling. Two other sing-song girls, also known as flowers, stand supportively behind their patrons' wooden chairs, looking over their shoulders at the bone and bamboo tiles, watching for wine glasses to refill and ready to whisper advice if asked. In an American household in 1921 Beijing, the table is in a living room of a traditional hutong house. Bright cushions on a black sofa sit near a Chinese desk and chair of dark wood. Two couples play mahjong together in elegant dress, the women in pressed waists and the men in suits despite the heat, wearing a long white robe, a Chinese servant knowledgeable in English, and the preferences of these foreigners, refreshes their tea and cocktails. If he plays mahjong, he does not tell them. While they delight in their knowledge of this Chinese game sweeping the foreign social scene in Beijing and Shanghai. The new fad travels to the United States, where a photographer poses four young white women, fashionably wearing bobbed hair and flowing sleeveless gowns in ornately carved Chinese chairs. The women's eyes stay focused on the tiles before them. Their photographed game will accompany the text in a 1923 instruction manual, helping introduce newcomers to the game that is exploding in popularity across the nation. French readers will eventually view their likenesses as well, in a translated edition that will compete with a cascade of other instruction manuals and media chatter about the game. On market day at a Chinese-American general store in Los Angeles during the early years of the Depression, a group of older men in button-down shirts play at a table in the back. Their years of labor do not slow the quickness of their hands in the game they have played for almost a decade. A long wooden chest of drawers holding dried herbs stands near the front door. On other shelves are newly arrived mail, outgoing remittances from the local clientele, and the mahjong set when it is not in use. A child in a pink pinafore watches them. Later that month, she will play mahjong with her grandmother during the Chinese New Year holiday. Two decades later, players' hands mix the tiles again, now made of plastic. On a grassy lawn, four women sit around a metal card table with a quilted fabric cover. A stone's throw away, a path leads to bungalow vacation homes, all occupied by Jewish families. A coin purse rests near one of the players' sandaled feet, and a cigarette case is by her hand. Their children swim and dig for worms. Most important, they are out of sight. This game will be followed by another and another this afternoon and the next. It is summer in the Catskill Mountains of upstate New York. Mahjong is a game of the senses. The tiles hold beauty, earthy tones of bone and bamboo, or yellowed butterscotch of aged plastic. They are heavy in the hand, with rounded edges rubbing against each other like river pebbles. Thumbs bump against grooves in the tiles from impossibly intricate carvings or brightly colored embossed images. Nothing else mimics the clatter of mahjong tiles running over each other on a hard table surface. Even a felt top does not entirely soften the din. Regardless of when and where the game is played, these experiences remain. They are part of what makes mahjong unique, and are no small part of its boundary-crossing appeal. Mahjong is both a cultural form and a material object that is made, bought, and bequeathed. Within the spaces between the tiles and the moments between games, distinct social cultures flourished. Despite the universal elements of how the game is played and the common feel of it, Mahjong reflected and helped express a range of meanings, especially. Emerging American modernity, Chinese American heritage, and Jewish American women's culture. In the holds of steamships, Mahjong traveled from China to the United States and became a quintessentially American game. Not in spite of, but because of its diverse manifestations. Its history of adaptation, amalgamation, and self-making offers unexpected insight into race, gender, class, and leisure in modern American culture. This book follows the history of one game to think about how, in their daily lives, individuals create and experience cultural change. Playing a game from a culture across the globe helped Americans create group identities and address issues of inclusion and exclusion. Mahjong, like other forms of leisure, played a significant role in the cultural transformations of the 20th century. There is no single answer to why the game was so resonant across different contexts. But the fact that it was, and that it inspired rich game-playing cultures, connects to some of the most important themes in modern American history. Its story is a window onto three pivotal areas of change in the 20th century United States. What did it mean to become modern in the early 20th century? How did American ethnicities take shape in the years leading up to and after World War II? How did middle-class women experience and shape their changing roles in society before the social revolutions of the late 20th century? How are these things related? Mahjong's history also prompts closer considerations of the meaning of leisure. Although players understood Mahjong first and foremost as a fun and challenging game, the specific social patterns they created on a broad scale had ramifications beyond any individual's conscious intent. Mahjong not only reflected larger social changes, but also allowed diverse groups to shape behaviors and ideas that had consequences of their own. During the 1920s Mahjong fad, for example, white women in elaborate Chinese costumes experimented with exotic personae and newly accessible forms of sexuality. Chinese American Mahjong instructors capitalized on the fad as an economic and cultural opportunity. And critics of the game recoiled from the social mobility of both white women and Chinese Americans. Each group's interactions with Mahjong were an important part of enacting, or coming to terms with, a modern national culture that included new gender norms and increasing racial diversity. Perhaps more than any other popular games, Mahjong had a complex cultural journey. Its history connects American expatriates in Shanghai, Jazz Age white Americans, urban Chinese Americans in the 1930s, Japanese Americans in wartime camps, Jewish American suburban mothers, and Air Force officers' wives in the post-war era. Over time, the material game changed. Bone and bamboo mimicked ivory. Later, the new plastics preserved the heft and feel of the tiles without relying on natural materials. So too, its significance shaped American understandings of Asia, the boundaries of gender and race, and ideas about leisure. Though rarely considered as part of American popular culture, Mahjong has in fact been a part of the nation's recreation for nearly a century. Its American story began in 1922, when newspapers on the West Coast started buzzing about the new old Chinese game. Unlike its marketing image as an ancient game, it had only recently become popular in a few urban centers in China, after its development as one of many male gambling games in the mid to late 1800s. A growing elite class of Chinese intermediaries facilitated Mahjong's introduction to Shanghai's burgeoning American population in the late 1910s. Promoters and travelers spread the game to the United States. Soon, the most elite Americans, from President and First Lady Harding to Hollywood starlets, were playing it. Just 2 years after its introduction, Americans made Mahjong sets Shanghai's sixth largest export to the United States. Congress even added a tax law specifically targeting Mahjong sets in 1924. As the American market developed a voracious appetite for the game, Chinese and Western merchants launched large-scale Mahjong factories in Shanghai that standardized production with artisanal workmanship. Mahjong helped inaugurate an era of fads: crosswords, miniature golf, flagpole sitting, and dance marathons all gained a rapt audience in the 1920s. Although forgotten today, the craze defined the era for decades afterward. Mahjong exploded into American consciousness at the height of immigration restrictions, nativism, and the mainstream national revival of the Ku Klux Klan. The irony of its popularity illuminates the complexities of consumerism, race, and the wary embrace of selective aspects of Chinese culture. In the 1920s, Americans imagined themselves learning a game of Confucius, a pastime of royalty, and the misty celestial ancients. Advertisers and players alike gleefully celebrated the great, exciting, hundreds of years old national Chinese game, now the craze of America. Yet Mahjong also represented the vulnerabilities of Western civilization. Even the stalwart game of bridge might fall before the sneaky pleasures of a yellow peril pastime. The racial and often racist tenor of the 1920s fad was unmistakable. In an era of pervasive xenophobia, why did this Chinese game achieve such widespread resonance? Its popularity was not just a result of individual appeal and enjoyment. The game itself allows for adaptability. That meant a wide range of people could use the game both for entertainment and for cultural purposes. In part, Mahjong helped Americans navigate the tensions of modernity. The simultaneous nostalgic yearnings and excited embrace of progress that marked the decade. Advertisers promised that it would provide players with an experience of ancient Eastern mystery, modern cosmopolitanism, and jazz age glamour. Society pages featured Mahjong matrons dressed in Chinese costume, from club women in Los Angeles to the Vanderbilts in Manhattan. Even small Mahjong parties allowed for experimentation in costume and exotic food. Embodying pre-modern authenticity and modern innovation, the mix of tiles, rules, and meanings created a site of play for the era's contradictions. It also fit into larger consumer patterns of the era. Even as actual contact with Chinese individuals became less likely for most Americans, most also became more likely to consume something Chinese, or that claimed to be Chinese. From silk pajamas and chinoiserie lamps to chop suey. At the same time, Chinese Americans leveraged Mahjong's popularity for economic opportunities in a discriminatory economy as new players hired Chinese teachers to help them master the rules. The idea that the game embodied some essence of Chinese culture could serve multiple purposes. The idea of China has been powerful for its symbolism. In addition to the famously derided coolie caricature, China has also represented a highly civilized past. More broadly, however, it exemplifies a potent, abstract concept of foreignness, one that is disconnected from China itself for modern Americans. Therefore, references to China can serve as a proxy for other social boundaries of inclusion and exclusion within the United States. Unlike card games that have become assimilated as American over time, because the Mahjong sets themselves bore material signs and engravings of their Chinese origins, the game retained its link to China and its ability to evoke a misty Orient. This liminal positioning, always linked both to China and the United States, made the game particularly malleable and enduring in building American identities. In China, the American-led global fad raised the game's profile, and it became known as a national treasure. Its meaning changed for Chinese Americans, too. For most Chinese Americans, the game evolved from its urban nightlife roots to become more domestic as white Americans engaged with the game for, ironically, its exotic appeal. In the interwar era, Chinese Americans found the game useful for navigating tensions associated with Americanization, including pressure to foster inclusion, survive exclusion, and nurture intra-cultural cohesion. Mahjong could be a point of commonality across generations because it was both Chinese and American, a Chinese game whose cultural meaning was transformed by American consumption. The history of how Mahjong became American is also a story of particular communities becoming American in the 20th century. Mahjong is woven into the uneven history of how the nation came to identify itself as a multiracial democracy, and how different groups experienced the possibilities, limitations, and potential costs of integration. By playing Mandarin, white Americans momentarily stepped out of their established identities through this Chinese game and its trappings, acculturating to a changing nation. Chinese Americans used this trans-Pacific consumer good to help them navigate questions of otherness and belonging. In America and in other countries, other Asian groups adopted the game. Japanese Americans first played the game in the fad years and picked it up again as one form of much-needed recreation while confined in so-called internment camps. And more marginal white Americans contributed to the complexity as Jewish families made Mahjong their own. The cultures Mahjong players created highlight ethnicity as constantly produced and unstable rather than natural or unchanging. By the 1930s, Mahjong continued to evolve in a national context that led to styles of play and forms of the game that became uniquely American. Formed in 1937 during an era of virulent anti-Semitism, the National Mahjong League never emphasized its strongly Jewish leadership, but its connection to Jewish women enabled the league's game to grow and become a key part of modern Jewish American culture, even as its game became known as national and eventually American Mahjong. The league emphasized Mahjong as a philanthropic activity during World War II, promoting both its link to Allied Chinese culture and, more important, enabling patriotic fundraising. Meanwhile, other specifically American variants have continued, though in smaller numbers than the Chinese versions and the League's game. Since World War II, the Officers' Wives Club in the Air Force has spread their version, known as Wright Pat Rules, after the Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, to bases around the world, establishing ties in transient military life. Jewish American women had been playing Mahjong since the 1920s fad, but the Cold War era nurtured a flourishing gendered Mahjong culture linked to the National Mahjong League. After World War II, the push toward increasingly suburban housing and widely shared entrance into full-time domesticity created a need for ways to overcome young mothers' frequently experienced isolation. Middle-class Jewish women also had the unique resource of culturally specific patterns of vacation communities to build upon. They were able to use the rhythms forged in bungalow colonies to claim time and space for themselves, not just for productive work, as in philanthropic or community groups, and not just during daytime or with husbands, but crucially, in ways that reimagined domesticity itself. By creating a community marker, they also shaped what is meant to be a middle-class Jewish woman in Cold War America. A diverse cast of characters people this history, from the stereotyped Chinese gambler and Jewish matron to influential individuals, including the oil representative come Mahjong entrepreneur Joseph Babcock, the Chinese-American sociologist Pardi Lo, and a forgotten founder of what would become American Mahjong, Dorothy Meyerson. They not only harnessed the game to pre-existing cultural meaning, but also created meaning unique to this game. Thus, people are not the only actors in this story. Sometimes Mahjong will serve as a lens, and sometimes as an agent. Taking this approach allows for distinguishing between the view of the interpreter, or what Mahjong allows us to see, and the meaning of the cultural form for the people who interacted with it, or the work Mahjong does in the world. At times, such as in the wartime incarceration of Japanese Americans, or in the development of plastics industries, Mahjong offers a window into larger political and economic stories. In other contexts, people attach ideas to the physical game, particularly ideas of foreignness and difference, and those ideas gave Mahjong a shaping force. The game rules also carried certain rhythms and ways for people to interact, including across multiple generations. Perhaps another game could have served these social functions. However, Mahjong had a unique combination of qualities. In addition to its sensory appeal, including the beauty and feel of the tiles, it took skill and concentration, not just luck. It was played in an intimate setting with regular groups of four or five people, and, importantly, it had a certain rhythm that facilitated communication and conversation. The tiles must be shuffled and stacked after each round of play, every 15 to 20 minutes, creating pauses that last longer than it takes to shuffle a deck of cards. The distinctive qualities of Mahjong are also key to understanding how this Chinese game became a vital part of women's culture in the post-war era. Outside Asian American communities, it had already become a women's game, not a game played by married couples. In those moments of pause, women created social bonds. At Mahjong, one player explained, women would let their hair down in ways they did not during other games. Mahjong's trajectory charts the fraught relationship of leisure in American culture, particularly along lines of class, ethnicity, and gender. Underlying the ability to play Mahjong is time without intentional productive purpose. After decades of effort from labor unions, the growth of a middle class, and a mass consumer economy, leisure and recreation became a defining aspect of modern American life in the 20th century, held out as a marker of progress. Most clearly, leisure has been associated with class privilege. In the early days of the Mahjong fad, advertisers featured scenes with maids and Mahjong, since both were signs of aspirational wealth. Yet leisure is a knottier issue than it first appears. Following the trail of Mahjong reveals sometimes surprising and often overlooked realms of leisure, of psychological survival, of community building, of cultural creation. Chinese immigrant laundry workers in the early 20th century were a far cry from the leisured classes, yet exhaustion did not prevent them from incorporating Mahjong into weekly rituals and nighttime games. The social aspects of leisure felt most keenly in new, uprooted environments like post-war suburban subdivisions and Air Force bases all over the world provided opportunities to build relationships. For Jewish Americans, women's games of Mahjong helped mark a shared territory in a middle-class context that risked assimilation into Christian America and created new cultural norms. Leisure activities have been just as foundational to ethnic formation as labor, education, and politics. Yet leisure that is not chosen, the enforced leisure of imprisonment, of anxious boredom, of endless uncertain waiting, is a terrible burden. The tensions between inclusion and exclusion defined the Asian American experience during the era of immigration restriction. In the 1920s and 1930s, male migrants detained at the Angel Island immigration station used recreation to carve out social spaces in a dehumanizing context. In a very different environment, Japanese Americans played Mahjong as a release from the pressures of disruption and anxiety in camps during World War II, while some tried to prevent recreation from turning into destructive gambling. The image of idleness has often been unsettling for Americans. For Chinese Christians and Christian missionaries, Mahjong carried a specter of the insidious dangers of a softened and respectable gambling game. In reality, Mahjong has long straddled the spectrum of gambling, to be both a game where large sums of money are won, lost, and fought over, as well as a family-friendly game played with pennies. By the time Mahjong entered popular culture, Protestant moralists and local governments had increasingly targeted gambling in particular as a threat to an orderly, meritocratic, industrial society based on the growing strength of middle-class mores around personal saving, work, and restraint over an embrace of luck. Examined outside these moral frameworks, gambling can also be understood as part of a mindset that embraces luck in an uncertain world. For the working poor, trying one's hand at dice, cards, or mahjong promised greater reward than a dead-end job ever would. Of course, the same factors that spark a desire for building community, mental stimulation, and relief of uncertainty can trigger addiction. Chinese immigrants were strongly associated with gambling and frequently targeted by police, in part because of long traditions of widespread gambling among migrant men, and in part because of simplistic stereotypes of moral lassitude. As a Chinese game, Mahjong seemed to dance on the edge of danger. In the face of such judgments, proponents of the game have struggled to legitimize their use of leisure by stressing perceptions of skill and money involved. Throughout the game's history in the United States, players and commentators have debated the appropriate combination of luck and skill present in the game. Experts in the game of bridge often unfavorably compared Mahjong to the intelligence and rational logic needed for bridge and urged Mahjong players to avoid incorporating more luck into the format of the game. Democratic pressures worked against their warnings, and over time, multiple forms of Mahjong have included more luck, though not without controversy. In the 1920s, the democratization of the game across social classes risked hurting its reputation, according to its elite chaperones, as rubes and poorly made sets entered the milieu. Founded by wealthy women, the National Mahjong League became the architect of American Mahjong and its eventual strong association with the middle class. For decades, the League has emphasized its role as a philanthropic organization. Recently, a modern Orthodox player felt her group's donation to the synagogue lent more class to what could otherwise be seen as a wasteful or inappropriate pastime, as did the participation of the rabbi's wife. The philanthropic element of Mahjong overlaps with the tradition of women's entertainment being put to obviously useful purposes in fundraising teas and galas. Many of the criticisms launched against Mahjong have been particularly barbed, engendered terms. As the game became increasingly associated with women, Mahjong players in the United States have often been viewed through the lens of motherhood and Mahjong's influence on distracted or self-centered mothering. In the 1920s, Mahjong-playing mothers were castigated for the juvenile delinquency of their wayward children. In the 1960s, an association between Mahjong and vacuous, all-consuming mothers became part of the Jewish mother stereotype. Alternatively, it could be seen as frivolous for layabout women who had nothing better to do. More appropriate for women, long tradition held, was the belief that a woman's work is never done. In contrast, an equivalently gendered game like poker has not suffered the same loss of prestige as a game for men who have nothing better to do. This history also revises interpretations of the roles women have played in each stage of transnational consumerism. Women have been predominantly viewed as iconic consumers, from Gilded Age matrons acquiring objects from the near and far East as participants in American empire, to housewives as consumer advocates and consumer citizens in post-war America. Historians of women have also challenged assumptions about the limited range of women's lives, largely by identifying involvement outside the home. This history reimagines women's labor in 20th century consumer culture, both within and outside their homes. From Shanghai social clubs to Chinatown apartments to Philadelphia townhouses, domestic space served as an arena not only for cultural transmission, but also for cultural creation through Mahjong as both a game and a springboard for community engagement. Mahjong-playing women combined consumption, production, and marketing when they worked as instructors and gamesmiths and were vital members of family manufacturing and distribution industries. As hostesses of Mahjong parties in Shanghai and in the United States, women helped create spaces for cultural exchange, social interaction, and political maneuvering. As Mahjong instructors, they built their own and their family businesses. From 1920s Manhattan to 1930s San Francisco to 1950s Wichita, women also used their homes as venues for female leisure in new ways. White women experimented with social boundaries via exotic Chinese costuming in the 1920s. Chinese American women established new access to respectable leisure, and Jewish women demarcated women-only zones of home-based recreation after World War II. These moves were part of cultural negotiations over women's place in the home. The history of Mahjong highlights leisure as a meaningful site of both change and contestation, which could also bring domestic spaces into the ostensibly public world of politics and business. Uncovering this history relies on a diversity of sources as complex as its makers, players, and promoters. There is no archive for Mahjong. Throughout its history, game producers, players, critics, and storytellers have left a range of evidence: photographs from 1920s factories in Shanghai, plays, paintings, and songs of Jazz Age Americans in thrall to the game, sociological notes from 1930s California Chinatowns, and newspapers and diaries from Japanese American incarceration camps during World War II. A dusty room off a board game factory floor in Massachusetts held the remnants of business files from the Mahjong Sales Company of America, the company that launched the global Mahjong fad. While the Schlesinger Library's Women's History Archive housed the records of an early instructor of the game. These sources demonstrate the broad range of expression that Mahjong inspired, as well as the different registers of society that it connects. Mahjong was widespread in the rituals and contours of interwar Chinese-American society and mid-century Jewish life, But in both cases, the activities of these individuals' daily lives were rarely kept in written records. The richest sources for these stories proved to be oral histories, transcribed interviews with Chinese men and women who had been detained at Angel Island Immigration Center in the 1920s and 1930s, as well as elderly Chinese Los Angelinos in the 1970s, revealed essential textures of community and individual lives. I also conducted dozens of interviews, one of which captured the rare perspective of a small-scale manufacturer of mahjong. Most of the interviews were with Jewish-American mahjong players and their children, resulting in more than 50 conversations in varying geographic locations and from a range of class strata. The size of the sample set was important in making arguments about specific patterns to allow for variations in circumstance, memory, and reliability. In addition, I sought out accounts from women who did not play mahjong or who actively disliked it in order to mitigate the biases that emerge from those eager to discuss a given topic. Together, they revealed remarkably consistent patterns around mahjong. From Atlanta to Philadelphia to Los Angeles, groups across the country played the same game at parallel places and times while noshing on similar snacks. These commonalities created a widely shared culture that reached its height in the post-war years of upward mobility, experienced in particularly pronounced ways by Jewish Americans. This study unfolds in two parts, from its Chinese origins to the Trans-Pacific consumer fad to American Chinatowns and suburbs. The first half is focused on Mahjong's history as related to consumerism, with a close examination of its economic and cultural origins, paying attention to trans-Pacific entrepreneurs, white women who dressed in Chinese costume to play the game, and Chinese Americans who asserted their ostensibly authentic ties to China, reveals how mass consumerism in a global frame helped Americans define what it meant to be modern in newly self-conscious ways. Chapter 1 begins in the midst of the 1920s fad, as the mahjong industry connected novel forms of doing business with established markets for oriental goods and patterns of home entertainment and sociability. Chapters 2 and 3 focus on the development and production of the game in the cosmopolitan world of Shanghai at the turn of the century. They reveal the social milieu of Americans living in China, where the game took root, and the Chinese factory workers who produced it while the exploding international market accelerated its reach. In chapters 4 and 5, the story recrosses the Pacific to examine the cultural dynamics of the massive mahjong vogue in the early 1920s, when American consumers capitalized on the game to navigate new gender dynamics and racial ideologies. The second half of the book explores how mahjong interwove with the experiences of inclusion and exclusion in the evolving definition of what it means to be American. While Chapter 6 traces mahjong in the development of Chinatowns between the World Wars and the game as a point of identity-building inclusion, Chapter 7 looks at mahjong as survival strategy in the exclusion of Chinese migrants at Angel Island Detention Center and Japanese Americans in wartime incarceration camps. Chapter 8 focuses on the creation of specifically American forms of the game, which lay the groundwork for the mahjong culture created by Jewish American women in post-war communities. Chapters 9 and 10 chart the development of Jewish American ethnicity through leisure, gender roles, and residential geography. An epilogue follows the recent history of the game, which parallels the nation's continued diversification in the late 20th century to showcase today's growing mahjong revival. Mahjong's American trajectory is a history of a mass-produced game that crossed and recrossed the Pacific, creating economic waves at the height of its popularity and creating a potent cultural symbol in its wake. It tells the story of the tensions between assimilation and cultural continuity that encourage the creation of identifiably ethnic communities. It also reveals the ways in which women leveraged a game to gain access to respectable leisure, and the backlash that often followed. Because the sets themselves carried specific visual markers as Chinese, the game could retain a certain element of foreignness, even as it became Americanized in style and form. Its associations with China were an essential part of the game's appeal, either as a new and exotic good or as a connection to cultural heritage. The game's adaptability created barriers as well as bridges as players pushed the evolution of distinctive Mahjong variants. Mahjong was, in essential ways, both outside and inside American culture. The link to China and the attendant American associations with difference provided an avenue for formation of simultaneous American identities, both related to and entirely independent of its Chinese origins. Mahjong players, promoters, entrepreneurs, and critics tell a broad story of American modernity. The apparent contradictions of the game, as both American and foreign, modern and supposedly ancient, domestic and disruptive of domesticity, reveal the tensions that lie at the heart of modern American culture. Chapter 1. The Mahjong Phenomenon. Men and women hurried from autos and streetcars toward the bright lights of the Granada Theater in San Francisco. It was September 23rd, 1922, and the spectacular stage production Mahjong Blues was about to start. Inside, young white women in Chinese costumes sold raffle tickets. The lucky winner would take home a Mahjong Sales Company Mahjong set with tiles of engraved bone and bamboo made by workers in Shanghai. The crowd had been reading articles for the last several months about the queer Chinese game that was sweeping the West Coast. Expectations were high, stoked by the Mahjong Sales Company's advertising campaign, which included publicizing the lyrics to the Mahjong Blues a few weeks before the show. These highlighted elements of the game in their translated Chinese imagery. When I build that Chinese wall, dragons, winds, and bamboos all, something seems to thrill me. Wow! Some attendees had likely been in the privileged audience at an elaborate Mahjong-inspired summer pageant at the Fairmont Hotel on Nob Hill. Those unfamiliar with this brand new game need not worry. Instructors were in the balcony, charging $1 to teach the game, all proceeds going to charity. Ushers handed eager moviegoers programs explaining the evening's entertainment, which would conclude with a silent film melodrama. Before the screen curtain went up, the stage was filled by a Chinese fantasy. The Mahjong Blues debuted with choreographed musical numbers suggested by the new Chinese game. This San Francisco movie palace was at the vanguard of a fad that would quickly become all the rage, the Chinese game Mahjong. Later that year, the Columbia Theater in Seattle staged its own Mahjong Blues production. Mahjong devotees did not have to rely on live performances. Soon they could listen at home to the Atlantic Dance Orchestra's recording of the upbeat blues. In the early 1920s, it was nearly impossible to live anywhere in the United States without encountering at least some chatter about the game from Spanish-language media in Texas and small-town newspapers in the Northwest, to films screened across the country and everything from fashionable shoes to ragtime tunes named after the game. How had Mahjong become an overnight sensation? However delightful it was to play, Mahjong was still an utterly unfamiliar game to most Americans when marketers first introduced it, and there was no guarantee they would be receptive. Yet key changes in popular culture and the economy, most importantly the growth of mass consumerism and a market for goods from the exotic East, primed the pump for a Mahjong craze in the 1920s. Unlike card games, Mahjong required a unique type of game set in order to play. Those sets and their weighty carved tiles provided much of the game's appeal. But they did not sell themselves. Entrepreneurs made use of the latest techniques in advertising, store display, and new forms of media like film to create and corner a Mahjong market, which involved building relationships with retailers as well as moving to squash competition through patents and litigation. The Mahjong industry connected novel forms of production, distribution, and marketing with established markets for oriental goods and patterns of home entertainment. Attract attention, create a desire, and supply merchandise that will sell. The single most significant early promoter of Mahjong was Joseph Park Babcock's Mahjong Sales Company of America. In the 1910s, Joseph Park Babcock was a Standard Oil representative from Indiana. Eventually stationed in Suzhou, just outside Shanghai, he learned enough language to communicate with the locals, an unusual skill for a foreigner. As his wife Norma explained, "We were in close contact with interesting Chinese people. We had few amusements in our small community of Americans and Europeans. My husband became an expert player and close student of the Chinese game." After picking up the game from acquaintances, Babcock claimed to have changed it in part through combining styles he learned from constant association with natives. He began working on a set of tiles with English letters and numerals, as well as written rules to help his friends, who had struggled to learn the game. His 1920 printed English language rules, which simplified elements such as the counting of points, helped spread the game among the Anglo-American community in Shanghai. Within a decade, he had built a Mahjong empire in the United States. Mainland Americans first began hearing about Mahjong when the Babcocks introduced it in the summer of 1920 to wealthy Angelenos vacationing on Catalina Island, off Southern California. They hoped this would serve as a useful test case for the game's potential popularity. They were right. After California high society pounced on the game, the Babcocks returned to Shanghai to pursue their ambitious entrepreneurial plans. Together with his friend Anton Lathine and Lathine's superior at the International Correspondence School, Albert Hager, who had the financial backing for the Mahjong Company of China, Joseph Babcock worked to spread his version of the game among Westerners in Shanghai and hoped to create an export market. Babcock and Hager joined with lumber merchant William A. Hammond to set up the new Mahjong Sales Company of America headquarters near the Port of San Francisco Ferry Building, where Hammond began receiving sets early in 1922. They, along with their vice president and general manager, J.M. Tees, launched an aggressive national marketing campaign. In the summer of 1922, they papered the country with advertisements for high-class specialty men wanted as sales agents, must-be organizers able to train men and to handle a big proposition. Poised for rapid expansion, they hoped to hire in at least 10 cities from New York and Boston to Indianapolis, Louisville, New Orleans, and El Paso. When the Pacific mail steamship Hoosier State docked in San Francisco in May 1922, the local press was ready to meet her high society passengers who brought with them an exciting new Chinese import, Mahjong sets. The game had only been in the country a few months, though trans-Pacific communication had already revealed that Mahjong was sweeping American expatriate circles in China. Passengers included members of New York and Atlanta society, whose skills as experts in the game were tested during the two Mahjong tournaments held during the ocean crossing. The fad had dominated steamship social halls during the 3-week voyage. The enterprising ship's barber sold 70 sets to passengers to take home, while stateside shops specifically marketed Mahjong sets as steamer gifts. Passengers brought with them more than 24 additional Mahjong sets to introduce to their friends in this country, as the game was already quickly gaining popularity on the West Coast. Just 2 days later, a department store advertised in the Los Angeles Times for Mahjong, that fascinating new old game that is sweeping the country by storm. Babcock and his business partners knew that the trend-setting New York market was critical for reaching the rest of the nation, and by the fall of 1922, they had failed to make significant inroads in the Northeast. Although readers of the New York Times had recently learned of China's fascinating super game, in a September article about the game's popularity among returned visitors to Shanghai, there was no ensuing media frenzy. The Mahjong company needed to create buzz around their branded product and to spark a sense of competition among those who were at the cutting edge of new trends. So Babcock gave his high-end sets to Hollywood film stars with a national reach like Douglas Fairbanks, who posed for photos playing the game with a set of tiles housed in an elaborately carved wooden cabinet. In November 1922, Mahjong Company Vice President J.M. Tees arrived at the Grand Hotel Pennsylvania in Midtown, Manhattan, which had been acclaimed as the greatest hotel center in the world. He brought with him news of the most fascinating game in the world, and its rapid spread across the Pacific Rim social scene from Shanghai to San Francisco. Without mentioning his business interests as a promoter of the game, Tees positioned himself as a traveling expert player who had bested players in the West but could simply not find worthy opponents in New York. "If there's anybody in your hotel who knows Mahjong, for heaven's sake, send them to me," he pleaded, on the front page of the hotel's in-house newspaper. Bellboys silently delivered the paper each morning to the rooms of the movers and shakers who stayed there. Tees cleverly pitched a match with the opera star Giovanni Martinelli and his wife Adele Previtali as his only game in New York. The clip of his Hotel Pennsylvania challenge was sent to Mahjong Company of China partner Albert Hager with a note. "Bert, this is what your friend Morris did. He said that isn't anything yet." Sure enough, a few days later, the New York Sun published a photograph of the famous couple playing with a Mahjong sales company set featured front and center, while Previtali pored over a copy of Babcock's copyrighted Book of Rules. The article credited a recent opera tour of Asia for Martinelli's knowledge of the ancient game of China, but the trademarked product placement was clear. A month later, there came to Washington from New York engraved invitations for a Mahjong party, hosted for the Washington military elite by Lew Henry Hoover, wife of Secretary of Commerce Herbert Hoover. Settling into the circulatory roots of leisured wealth, Mahjong coursed through Newport, Rhode Island, the Berkshires in Massachusetts, and Palm Beach, Florida. Norma Babcock proudly claimed Mahjong as the first good not only to spread from the United States to the rest of the world, but from the West Coast to boot. Its widespread popularity and international social fame, she asserted, conclusively proves that the Pacific Coast now holds the point of vantage over the Atlantic and explodes the idea that all worthwhile things must be introduced in an eastern metropolis to prove successful. As their business strategy showed, however, the Mahjong sales company understood that the East Coast still held outsized cultural influence. By the end of 1922, Mahjong was officially a craze. Throughout the next 2 years, African-American club women in Newark, married couples in Chicago, teenagers in Boston, white socialites in Seattle, and housewives in Atlanta helped spread the game in their communities, while the initial coastal markets continued to increase their consumption. As Tees explained in 1923, "We feel that we have accomplished what we have set out to do. attract attention, create a desire, and supply merchandise that will sell. For the Mahjong Sales Company of America, the game's explosive success was a mixed blessing. The company sought early on to retain control over and dominate the Mahjong market. Hager registered a trademark, and Babcock filed a patent for the game to be known under the name of Mahjong, with the hyphen and double G marking the genuine article. But the patent was slow in coming. Hager filed for additional patents on behalf of the Mahjong Company of China for the ornate wooden cabinets for holding games and the pieces used to keep score. Meanwhile, other manufacturers in Shanghai and the United States proliferated and sold Mahjong under a wealth of brand names, from Pa Luk and Peng Chao to the ancient game of the Mandarins. In a particularly egregious attempt to horn in on the Mahjong brand, a company producing a cheap cardboard set in Chicago highlighted its Mahjong title while explaining it was actually pronounced Mu-Yunk, and therefore they insinuated, clearly innocent from copyright infringement. Babcock's company advertised its sets for sale in authorized stores and hotels. Even as it quickly lost an uphill battle to control what and who could market Mahjong, or as they preferred to think of it, Mahjong-like games. In 1922, the Mahjong Sales Company tried to enforce brand loyalty by suing the high-profile San Francisco home furnishing store, Gump's, which specialized in Asian luxury goods, for sales of apparatus and rules for playing the Chinese domino game in violation, it is alleged, of patent rights and copyrights. It also sued the San Francisco importers H.S. Crocker Company and Philip Naftali. Babcock demanded their imposter inventory be destroyed and argued that such companies skimmed unearned profits while for years he diligently studied the game. Naftali, for his part, continued building his reputation as a Mahjong rulebook author, but published his second book under the title of Ma Chuk. 2 years later, Babcock unsuccessfully tried to halt manufacturers in Amsterdam and Frankfurt as the game spread across Europe. Despite the Mahjong Sales Company's best efforts, after the game's initial introduction, it was never again the only major distributor. Even as Babcock filed a patent for his improvement in games, the game was spreading along various other routes. Not company sales agents, but rather society matron Carolyn Snowden Andrews Fahnestock introduced the game to politicos and military leadership in Washington, D.C. in November 1922. While the widow of financier Gibson Fahnestock reportedly picked up her set in Europe, others brought sets from San Francisco. Lilia Montague Barnett carried the game back from Asia after accompanying her husband, Commandant of the Marine Corps General George Barnett, on an official trip to Japan. Representative Harry Hawes of St. Louis further spread the game when he gifted Mahjong sets to more than a dozen Washington households.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.